Morning.
Morning.
Good to see you this morning as we worship together our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in this place where God is present. This is a special day, and you'll find out more about that later on. We'll be wishing Peyton Godspeed today, and so that and the choir looks larger than the congregation this morning. That's very nice. Thank you, choir members, for being there today. We will have a special reception for Peyton after the late service. I really hope that you will take the time to come back at around 12:15, 12:30 for that. If you would still like to make a monetary gift for him for the next step of his career in life, you may still do that this morning during the offering plate, or give it to Meg or Katie. They're standing. Well, Katie's right there. Katie, wave at Katie. Yeah. Give it to her this morning, and that would be great to do today. Thursday morning Bible study begins on the 6th of September. Week after next, we're going to be doing something called Clash of Kingdoms, which talks about Paul and the clash of him with the Roman Empire of that day. It's a video-based Bible series, and I hope that you will join us if you are able to at 10 a.m. on Thursday mornings. It's a great class and great discussions. God's Work Our Hands is coming up on the weekend of the 8th and 9th of September. Sign-up sheets will be in the narthex this morning. I encourage you to sign up. A couple are closed already because we have all the people that we need for them. So look at the available ones. There's probably 8 or 9 still left where you can serve. God's Work Our Hands is an ELCA initiative for churches all over the country to serve in their communities on these 2 days, this one weekend. Obviously, we do many other things as well, but there are hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of people serving in their communities on that weekend after Labor Day weekend. So I hope that you will be part of that as well. I've been asking, I continue to ask, please wear your name tag so that we can all know each other. And if you're a guest this morning, it's great to have you here. I hope that everybody will fill out their connection cards so that we know that you were here, and also so that if you have prayer concerns or any concerns, that we can address those this coming week in our prayer and with our prayer warriors. Let's start our worship now with a prayer. Thank you. to stand now and face the cross as we begin our worship this morning.
Thank you.
Holy God, your word feeds your people with life that is eternal. Direct our choices and preserve us in your truth, that renouncing what is false and evil, we may live in you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You can be seated. I'd like to invite the children forward for children's time with the scripts.
God had performed unbelievable miracles. He brought the plagues against Egypt. He parted the Red Sea. He made sure that they had food and water. He protected them in battles. He did everything. He led them the whole way and protected them. Yet they still complained. The Promised Land was right there for the taking. And so they sent 12 spies to check it out. Well, when the spies returned, they said, yes, the land is indeed full of milk and honey, just like God promised. And two of them said, yes, we should overtake the land. This is what God wants for us. But 10 of those 12 spies complained. The people are way too big. They're stronger than us. We'll never win. We should not attack. Those complaints, that negative attitude, the fear, it spread throughout the camp. And the Israelites lost faith in God. They were so close to the Promised Land. But instead of trusting that God would help them be victorious in a battle, which he'd already done many times, it was easier for them to just sit there and complain. Do you think God likes complaining? No, I don't think so. When you complain, basically you're showing a lack of faith for God's plan for you. All right. Scientists have proven that complaining is contagious. It will spread faster than the flu, okay? Complaining is bad for your health. It gets your blood pressure up, and it lowers your immune system, which means you're gonna get sick more than other people. Once you get in the habit of complaining about things, and we all know complainers, we all have that person in our life that always finds a reason to complain. Once you get into that habit, your brain rewires itself so that when you look at something, you see the bad first. Often you totally miss out on the good. And that's what was happening to the Israelites. They were only seeing the bad. No matter how many times God showed them the good. And it's because of all that complaining that they wandered for 40 more years in the desert. Now, we all complain. We just went over that, right? And I wonder if I asked your parents the same question, how many times a day you complain, if I would get that same answer that you gave me. I bet their number would be a little higher. Okay, so 200? Oh, wow, okay. Well, we all find ourselves in situations where we want to complain, where we don't like what's happening, it doesn't seem fair, and usually it's a little scary. And right now for me, my complaint is, I don't want Peyton to leave. And I'm sure I'm not the only one. I don't like him. Why does he have to leave? It's scary thinking of how we're going to get along without his leadership in this town. But we have to remember that God knows what's best. He knows what's best for Peyton, and right now that's going to Colorado. And he knows what's best for Advent, and he's going to help us find somebody to take Peyton's job and to lead us in worship. Let's pray about that. Dear God, we need your help. Help us to do everything without complaining. Help us to trust you and have faith in your plan. Help Peyton to grow his ministry. And help us find the right person to lead us as we gather to worship you. In Jesus' name.
Coming up on the weekend of the 8th and 9th of September, sign-up sheets will be in the narthex this morning. I encourage you to sign up. A couple are closed already because we have all the people that we need for them. So look at the available ones. There's probably 8 or 9 still left where you can serve. God's Work Our Hands is an ELCA initiative for churches all over the country to serve their communities on these 2 days, this one weekend. Obviously, we do many other things as well, but there are hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of people serving in their communities on that weekend after Labor Day weekend. So I hope that you will be part of that as well. I've been asking, I continue to ask, please wear your name tag so that we can all know each other. And if you're a guest this morning, it's great to have you here. I hope that everybody will fill out their connection cards so that we know that you were here, and also so that if you have prayer concerns or any other concerns, that we can address those this coming week in our prayer and with our prayer warriors. Let's start our worship now with prayer. Thank you. ask you to stand now and face the cross as we begin our worship this morning. Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Holy God, your word feeds your people with life that is eternal. Direct our choices and preserve us in your truth, that renouncing what is false and evil, we may live in you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. I'd like to invite the children forward for children's time with the script. The land is indeed full of milk and honey, just like God promised. And two of them said, yes, we should overtake the land. This is what God wants for us. But 10 of those 12 spies complained. The people are way too big. They're stronger than us. We'll never win. We should not attack. Those complaints, that negative attitude, the fear, it spread throughout the camp. And the Israelites lost faith in God. They were so close to the promised land. But instead of trusting that God would help them be victorious in a battle, which he'd already done many times, it was easier for them to just sit there and complain. Do you think God likes complaining? No, I don't think so. When you complain, basically you're showing a lack of faith for God's plan for you. All right. Scientists have proven that complaining is contagious. It will spread faster than the flu, okay? Complaining is bad for your health. It gets your blood pressure up, and it lowers your immune system, which means you're gonna get sick more than other people.
once you get in the habit of complaining about things, and we all know complainers, we all have that person in our life that always finds a reason to complain. Once you get into that habit, your brain rewires itself so that when you look at something, you see the bad first. Often you totally miss out on the good. And that's what was happening to the Israelites. They were only seeing the bad. No matter how many times God showed them the good. And it's because of all that complaining that they wandered for 40 more years in the desert. Now, we all complain. We just went over that, right? And I wonder if I asked your parents the same question, how many times a day you complain, if I would get that same answer that you gave me. I bet their number would be a little higher. Okay, so 200? Oh, wow, okay. Well, we all find ourselves in situations where we want to complain, where we don't like what's happening, it doesn't seem fair, and usually it's a little scary. And right now for me, my complaint is, I don't want Peyton to leave. And I'm sure I'm not the only one. I don't like him. Why does he have to leave? It's scary thinking of how we're going to get along without his leadership in this town. But we have to remember that God knows what's best. He knows what's best for Peyton, and right now that's going to Colorado. And he knows what's best for Advent, and he's going to help us find somebody to take Peyton's job and to lead us in worship. Let's pray about that. Dear God, we need your help. Help us to do everything without complaining. Help us to trust you and have faith in your plan. Help Peyton to grow his ministry. And help us find the right person to lead us as we gather to worship you. In Jesus' name.
Strike them with pestilence and disinherit them, And I will make of you a nation greater and mightier than they. But Moses said to the Lord, then the Egyptians will hear of it. For in your might you brought up this people from among them. And they will tell the inhabitants of this land. They have heard that you, O Lord, are in the midst of this people. For you, O Lord, are seen face to face, and your cloud stands over them, and you go in front of them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Now, if you kill this people all at one time, then the nations who have heard about you will say, it's because the Lord was not able to bring this people into the land that he swore to give them, that he slaughtered them in this wilderness. And now, therefore, let the power of the Lord be great in the way that you promised when you spoke, saying, the Lord is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, forgiving iniquity and transgression, but by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the parents upon the children to the third and fourth generation. Forgive the iniquity of this people according to the greatness of your steadfast love. Just as you have pardoned this people from Egypt even until now. Here ends the reading. We will read Psalm 103 responsibly. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits.
Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit, and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
Who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles.
The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed.
He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel.
The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever.
He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him.
As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us.
I invite you now to stand as we welcome in the gospel.
Jesus heard this, he was amazed and said to those following him, truly I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west, and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, "Go, let it be done just as you believed it would." And his servant was healed at that very moment. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Are stuck in a spiritual survival mode. Too much to do, not prioritizing our faith. Maybe we have settled for spiritual mediocrity. We have to ask ourselves, does this brand of faith that I have and you have produce the kind of results in our lives that you read about in the biblical story of men and women of faith in the Bible? Chances are we're not even close, but we could, and we should be, because our faith should and can connect the greatness of God with each of our potentials to do great things on His behalf. So let's meet two biblical characters today that showed their faithfulness that God wants each of us to have. First, meet the centurion. He comes to Jesus asking for help. "My most trusted servant is home paralyzed and he's suffering terribly." Jesus asks if the centurion would like him to heal the servant. And the centurion, who we discover is a very humble man, says, "I am a man who has authority over many people. I am a very powerful man, but I am helpless to heal my servant." And Jesus compliments him for his honesty, his integrity, and his willingness to come off of his position of authority to save his servant. The centurion, who is not even a follower of Jesus, was commended by Jesus for his audacious faith. Faith bigger than those who called themselves followers of Jesus. It's amazing. The one whose faith is on display is not any Jew, nor the teachers, nor the Pharisees, nor the Sadducees, nor the scribes, but an outsider in the Jewish religious establishment. Centurion was a Roman. Son, stand still as we observe and maybe even envy this out-of-the-box follower of Jesus. Meet Joshua. Most of us who ever went to Vacation Bible School remember Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho. He probably sang it till nauseated to us. But his story begins long before that day. He was born into slavery, which was the fate of all the Jews who were living in Egypt. And on the journey to the Promised Land, Joshua rose to a position of leadership as Moses' assistant. Then, just when they were almost to the Promised Land, disaster strikes. When the people heard that the giants and cities with high walls stood between them and taking possession of their destiny, the Promised Land. And they panicked. Everybody wanted to go back. Everyone except Joshua and his friend Caleb. Like the other spies, Joshua and Caleb returned from their scouting trip to the Promised Land with a message of faith, not fear. They said, "The land that we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. The Lord is pleased with us, He will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and He will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord. And do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. But at that time, fear won out. God's people didn't understand that if you want to really experience God's blessings, audacious faith, out-of-the-box faith is essential. Even after all the miracles that they had witnessed in the desert, they still had not grasped what seemed impossible for them to accomplish. And that was exactly what God wanted them to accomplish. And 40 wasted years followed. I feel for Joshua. To my mind, 40 years of enduring the consequences of other people's bad decisions would be enough to derail anybody's faith. Yet Joshua never flinched. Never gave in. He never lost sight of God's promises. And when Moses died, God chose Joshua to be his successor. Big sandals to fill. Most ordinary believers would back down, but Joshua didn't. He stepped up. And why? I think it's because Joshua was motivated, just like the centurion. And just like we can be, by audacious faith in God's goodness, in God's power. And Joshua changed the world of his generation. Imagine this, before Joshua took over, God's people were migrants. They were living hand to mouth. They were nomads wandering all over the ancient Near East. Afterwards, they were settlers, owners of the exceedingly good land God had promised them. At this point, I can understand if you're thinking this. I'm not sure I see how a Bible Heroes military campaign relates to my life. My most exciting daily battles are navigating stop and go traffic at 7 a.m. without doing violence to anyone. Or going to a job I'd just do anything to quit. Or getting my kids or grandkids to clean their rooms at night without any bloodshed. But stay with me a little bit longer. The story God has for each of our lives isn't inferior to Joshua's or the centurion's. There is an exceedingly good land that's still there, that still God wants us to occupy. And as you put yourself into this story, something life-changing might happen to you. My favorite story about Joshua doesn't get enough airtime, but it's tucked away in another part of the Old Testament, in the book of Joshua, chapter 10. There's a story of audacious faith that I'd like you to know more about. And it all centers on a preposterous prayer. As a matter of fact, it seems like Joshua is insulting God. But God isn't intimidated by our long shot prayers. As chapter 10 opens, in the book of Joshua, we read that four opposing Amorite armies are plotting to attack the Israelites. Having decided to strike first, Joshua leads his entire army towards the Amorites on an all-night march. Sometime during that march, God spoke to Joshua, and God told him, "Do not be afraid of the Amorites. I have given them into your hand. Not one of them will be able to withstand you." At dawn, then, the Israelites unleash a surprise attack. And right from the beginning, the battle goes well for the Israelites. The Israelites break the enemy lines, and the Amorites start to run away. Joshua's men start to chase them down, and God got personally involved. In the 11th verse of Joshua 10, it says, "The Lord hurled large hailstones down on them from the sky, on the Amorites." Then as the sun sank below the horizon, Joshua faced a very difficult decision. The victory wasn't complete, and once it got dark, the rest of the Amorites would just run away. But Joshua was determined to continue the fight. Maybe you realize that if he didn't defeat the Amorites then, that they might come back strengthened at a later time. We don't know. Maybe you realize that anything other than total victory would conceal God's glory and God's presence. Plus, he remembered God's promise that night. Not one of them will be able to withstand you. In our first reading today, it says much the same thing. Do not be afraid of the people of the land, because you will devour them. Well, most of us would probably have called it a day. I've done all I can do. I've exhausted every option. I've given it all I've got. But Joshua was not most people. He refused to go out like that. That wasn't the way it was supposed to end. This is where his audacious faith begins. Joshua sized up the situation, summoned all the courage that he could have, and delivered one of the most unusual prayers in the whole Bible. Oh sun, stand still over Gibeon. Oh moon, over the valley of Ajaya. I just love this story. Joshua had the audacity to ask God to make the sun stop in the sky. To freeze time on behalf of the Israelite people. Not possible, we say. But according to Scripture, God gave Joshua exactly what he wanted. Just when the Amorites were hanging on till darkness, darkness never came. Joshua 10, 13, and 14 report this. The sun stopped in the middle of the day and delayed going down about a full day. There has never been a day like that before or after. Surely, the Lord was fighting for Israel. Now, a skeptic in me has all kinds of questions. Did God actually stop the earth on its axis? Did he create some type of substitute sun to extend the daylight? In other words, what really happened here? Well, we don't know the answer to any of those questions. But my faith is pretty simple. I choose to believe that the same God who intervened to bring his son back to life intervened on this day in history to help the chosen people. He chose to answer Joshua's outrageous prayer. God did what only God can do. And God did it in a way that his people would never forget. Could it be that God intends for us to have the same kind of audacious faith as the centurion, as Joshua? The kind of faith that dares to believe God for the impossible is a normal way of our everyday life. I believe that's exactly what God wants. I believe he still desires to make the sun stand still over the life of every believer if we just have the audacity to ask and keep asking till God answers our prayers. I think each of us is called to be a Joshua. If only we'll ask and have the audacity to keep asking. If we have the audacity to ask, God has the ability to answer our prayers. Wouldn't you like to know how it feels to see God accomplish the impossible right in front of your eyes? I do. And I want you to as well. And I particularly want it for this church. Story of the centurion and Joshua hint at a God-sized transformation that is available to every single follower of Jesus Christ. Risk it. Ask God for the power to have an audacious faith like Joshua. Amen.
God who sent us, thank God.
stand for the prayers. Trusting in our loving and almighty God, who abundantly provides the bread of life to all who hunger, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. That God bless the church universal in every place, inspiring strength and courage to boldly proclaim the mystery of the gospel. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
That God, the Creator, bless wild animals and family pets, prairies and kitchen gardens, beaches and sandboxes, mountains and hearths. Let us pray.
Hear our mercy, O God.
That God spread the gospel throughout the nations of the world, announcing the words of eternal life to peoples in every land and country. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
That God remember the poor and the brokenhearted and rescue all those in trouble. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
That God protect members of this congregation all along our ways and empower us to serve Christ in sincerity and faithfulness. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
That God redeem the lives of those who have served in the faith and raise them up according to the promises of Jesus Christ, the bread that nourishes eternal life. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Almighty and loving God, we look to you in hope and trust, knowing that you will do far more than we can ask or imagine. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the offerings.
The storm is passing over.
Let us pray. Merciful God, you open wide your hand and satisfy the need of every living thing. You have set this feast before us. Open our hands to receive it. Open our hearts to embrace it. Open our lives to live it. We pray this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all those who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered unto one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Take together.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated and follow the directions of the ushers.
Thank you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Go with God's peace.
Peyton,
do you recognize recognize and accept the completion of your ministry with Advent Lutheran Church?
I do, and I give thanks to God for our ministry together.
Amen. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, you gave the holy apostles many gifts and commanded them to feed your flock. You equip your people with abilities that differ according to the grace given to them, and you called them to various avenues of service. We give you thanks for Peyton's ministry among the people of God in this place. You watch over our going out and our coming in. Bless this time of ending and beginning. You surround your people in every time and every place. Keep us close in your love. You accompany your people in times of joy and times of trial. Prosper all that has been done to your glory in this time together. Heal and forgive all that has fallen short of your will for all of us. Help us all to live with courage and gladness in the future that you gave to us. As Peyton has been a blessing to us, so now send him forth to be a blessing to others. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Will you rise for the benediction? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
The Spirit sends us forth to serve.
Thanks be to God.